It's absurd to think that the second most successful shared universe in Hollywood, at least in terms of breadth and scope, is probably The Conjuringverse, the film franchise built around a married couple who've devoted their lives to paranormal investigation. Honestly, hashtag relationship goals. The Conjuring: The Devil Made Me Do It is the third entry in the main series. It's directed by Michael Chaves, who had previously helmed the franchise's The Curse of La Llorona, also known as the second best La Llorona-focused horror movie of 2019. The Conjuring franchise is an interesting piece of horror nostalgia. In the original films, director James Wan drew heavily from iconic and popular 70s horrors to create what was effectively a mass-market counterpoint to the more artsy nostalgia that informs the contemporary work of director Ari Aster on films like Hereditary and Midsommar. Building off Wan's success with Insidious, The Conjuring effectively brought horror back to basics, after a decade of found footage horror and schlocky remakes. Chaves builds on a lot of what made Wan's previous two entries in the franchise so appealing to audiences, offering a very classical and traditional approach to horror. Like the other films in the franchise, The Devil Made Me Do It is not embarrassed of a jump scare. The film is populated with strange shapes barreling the camera from dark shadows, and scored by an orchestra that isn't afraid to let the audience know when they should jump in their seats. It's not especially artful or sophisticated, but there's something appealing in its bluntness. The Devil Made Me Do It is at its best when it directly embraces these old-fashioned techniques. Chaves borrows several cues from Wan, such as long takes through standing sets to orient the audience before things start getting strange. The film is more uncanny and effective when it leans on practical effects rather than CGI. A cereal box scattering of its own volition is scarier than an obviously computer-generated body contorting in impossible ways. One of the more interesting aspects of the Conjuring franchise is its wedding of classic horror tropes to modern blockbuster conventions and high concepts, arguably marking it as a spiritual successor to the big populist horrors of the 70s. The Conjuring 2 remains one of the rare horror movies to feature a car chase climax, a subgenre with far too few entries. The Devil Made Me Do It, very loosely, takes its cues from a real-life court case in 1981, in which the defendant pleaded not guilty by way of demonic possession. The Devil Made Me Do It teases the possibility of a demonic legal drama, evoking Scott Derrickson's criminally underrated The Exorcism of Emily Rose. However, the film pivots sharply into something closer to a mythic conspiracy thriller. The Devil Made Me Do It signals the series' transition from the 70s into the 80s in interesting ways. The movie opens with obligatory shoutouts to 70s horrors like The Exorcist and Carrie, but by the climax the film is drawing from The Shining. The film marks the new decade with Blondie, Waterbeds, and Satanic Panic. Of course, there's something uneasy about a blockbuster purporting to be based on true events, vindicating the 80s satanic ritual abuse panic through the perspective of a real-life couple that the New England Skeptical Society described as dangerous frauds. But we don't have the space to unpack that here, so let's just leave that aside. The Devil Made Me Do It is an interesting genre hybrid, but it doesn't quite work. The film's structure relies heavily on flashbacks and exposition, which undercuts the kind of mounting dread and escalation that a story like this needs to function. Individual set pieces work reasonably well, but don't add up to a greater whole. The result is something of a weird curio, a trinket perhaps best locked away for study. The Conjuring: The Devil Made Me Do It is available in cinemas and on HBO Max now.